The stock market's been on fire this year, and a lot of people are trying to figure out how to invest their money. Some people prefer art and coins. Some people prefer stocks. I prefer cars. And if you're going to invest in the stock market, you can go out in your garage and look and touch your own investment. But there's a bull market list out there. We're going to go through that list. We're going to tell you which ones make sense. And then we're going to add a few suggestions that might just meet your budget. Welcome back to the channel. I'm Lauren Fix.
And I'm Paul Fix.
If this is your first time to the channel, we do more than car reviews and first looks of new cars.
We give you car smarts because knowledge is power.
Make sure to subscribe and click that little bell so you don't miss anything. Collecting cars is something that you and I both do.
Mm-hmm.
Paul's got a few cars. I've got a lot more cars. But over the years, you know, you start to pick up cars that you know are going to increase in value. And every year we test drive about 1,000 different cars.
I'd say.
And some of them are really awesome. Some leave them at the dealer and let people just use them as transportation. But people are starting to invest in cars. They want to know, what do I invest in? And every year, Hagerty.com, mm-hmm. puts out a bull list of cars they think are going to go up in value with their people. We're going to go through that list, but some of them I don't agree with. What do you think?
Some of them I do agree with, but only for weird reasons, just because you know, we're in this area where cars from the 80s are starting to become popular. Imports are starting to become popular. Those weird cars from the 90s that nobody ever liked when they were brand new, they're starting to become popular.
Right. You know, it's funny. I think it's the money you have in your pocket. So when you're younger, you can only afford a certain price point. As you get older, you have more disposable cash. And you remember those cars when you were in high school. So for me, it's a different type of car. Like the cars I drove in high school that I would never own again, you might want. So for me, it's a 65 Shelby. I wasn't in high school then, but I love the cars of the 80s and so forth. That's when I was in school. But for you, you were in school in a totally different period.
Well, when I was growing up, I desperately wanted a Nissan 350Z, which is not really a collector car, but maybe one day it will be. I mean, look, the Honda S2000 is getting huge.
Right.
The Porsche 996s and 997s from the early 2000s, those are becoming incredibly popular.
Audi R8s?
Yes, absolutely.
We had one when you were in high school.
Yeah, for a very brief time before it broke down.
Yeah, and a couple of the vehicles that are on this list are from that era, and some of them are brand new. And we're going to cover that in the end. You want to stay with us to the end. We're going to give you a bottom line and talk about a few vehicles today that if you bought them brand new off the lot, you're not going to get hurt. And there are some vehicles that are daily drivers and some vehicles that are pretty unique. And, of course, we talk about those all the time. So I think we should get started at the list.
All right, let's do it.
All right. And then before we do that, I'm going to say this, okay?
Yeah. Do you
want
to?
Yeah. No, you want me to hold it?
If you want to.
Okay. Well, how about if we just move it
over? Here, I can grab it. I can be your hand model.
Let's put it right there. Okay. All right.
Do you want me to do
No, I don't. You can if you want. I don't care. I'm going to look right to the camera. If you're doing that and I'm not looking, it'll look funnier. So I'm just ignoring it. Ready? All the tips and a lot of the car information that we talk about on every one of our Friday segments is in my book, Lauren Fix's Guide to Loving Your Car. If you need a gift for a new driver, you just want to learn more about cars and you want to have car smarts, check out that book. There's a link down below and you can have one on your bookshelf.
So forecasting can be very tricky. What we thought was going to happen in 2020 was completely thrown out the window because of the pandemic, and cars that we may have thought were going to be good investments weren't so very good, and vice versa. And that actually goes for many different things, the housing market and, you know.
Well, the production numbers are off too.
Yeah.
I mean, we thought there was going to be all these Corvettes, and then they had a problem with parts, then they had a problem with the union, and then they had COVID, and then everything else. So they've had a lot of issues.
Right.
So, some of the cars that aren't on the list, you know, we'll be talking about those short production runs might increase the value of those collectibles.
Right. And these unforeseen circumstances, essentially, can change the market in ways that if you were eagle-eyed, or if you already have the right car, all of a sudden it was worth nothing one day, and the next day it's worth a buttload. So you never know what's going to happen.
Well, I think the manufacturers change their minds too. You know what I mean? Like we're going to talk about that at the end. You know, oh, we're going to make all these cars for so long. Oh, we changed our mind. We're not going to make that anymore.
Or the opposite, which would happen with the GT. Mm-hmm. The Ford GT was supposed to be a very short run, and they ended up quadrupling the number of cars that they made.
Not happy as a Ford GT owner, but they already know that. I've already let Ford know my peace of mind. Let's get into this list too. Well, they didn't listen. They never listened to me. I'm just Lauren Fix the Car Coach. Let's take a look at this list, Paul. The first car is the 2011 to 2012 Lexus LFA. Now, you probably haven't driven one. I have. Mm. These are rocket ship cars. They're V10, 4.8 liter. They've got 553 horsepower, 354 pound-feet of torque. It only weighs like 3,500 pounds. So these are like race cars.
Right.
And they didn't make a lot of them. And thing is, people that drive them, they're like, oh my God, these things are awesome.
Everything I've heard about them has been...
Except for the price. The original price on this car was like $350,000.
Which for what most people thought the car was, especially in comparison to other supercars, and I guess it's starting to get into that area of like between the supercar and like the ultra exotic cars.
But if you own one, is it an exotic? It's a super cool car.
I don't
think
anybody sees it that way because it's
like an RS200. Yeah, it's a cool car.
It doesn't have enough horsepower. It's not as high performing as it should be. I don't think it was it a race car? I don't think it
was. Well, we had them on the track, but you know, when you're looking at 553 horsepower and not that much torque of 354, but there's a limited production run. And so some of the things you want to know when you're going to buy a vehicle that you're going to keep as an investment, it has to have three critical factors. It's true when you're watching Barrett Jackson, Meekum, or anything. The cars that get the big money have to have a story behind them. They have to have what we call provenance. Mm-hmm. Now, we've taken cars to Amelia Island, and we've won there, so we kind of know what that's all about. But it also has to have a limited production run, and there has to be high demand. So there might be a limited production run of, you know, Rangers with V6s in them. Who cares? But if there's a high demand for it, suddenly the price goes up. And we'll talk about some of those cars at the end that are current production, that there's a high demand and there's low production, or high production, just a high demand. So there's a lot of things that you have to know, and that's why it's important to do your research before you make any choices. And I don't know about this LFA.
I'd say one of the interesting things about it is that when it was brand new, everyone thought that the technology was super cool, but because of the numbers, and a lot of people always like to harp on stats.
It's 500 cars, that's it.
Right, but it wasn't very popular.
Right,
people thought it was cool, but no one really wanted to buy one.
A Lexus at $350,000?
Right.
Yeah, they're not going to sell a lot of those. And they do have a couple Lexus supercars that are available today.
Yep.
I don't know. I like the convertible over the coupe but LC. Okay.
You have $350,000 brand new. Do you buy an LFA or do you buy a Ferrari?
I'm buying a Ferrari.
Exactly.
And that's what happens. You will never get hurt unless you're buying, you know, some really strange piece of something that's got a bad history or high mileage.
And now the evaluated price, we're looking at $550,000 to $580,000. Right. So if you've bought one brand new, you're holding on to it. Or if you have the opportunity to buy one now that's at a nice discount, it's in good shape, then this is an incredible investment.
If you can find one.
Yeah, if you can find one.
But the value is up about 18% since last year. So if you've got that kind of cash, you got $500,000 laying around, are you going to buy an LFA? You should put that in the comments down below. Because if I got $500,000 laying around, I ain't buying an LFA. I don't know about you.
I don't have $500,000 laying around.
All right, the next vehicle on the list is interesting. This has become like Tim Kuniskis, who is the SRT guy. He's the guy behind all the performance in Mopar cars. If you're a Mopar guy and you're like, demons, Hellcats, all right, what if you took the SRT8 and put it into a Jeep Grand Cherokee? That's a rocket ship, you know, 6.1 liter, 420 horsepower, but it has 420 pound-feet of torque. That's a beast.
That's enough to throw your head back in the seat.
I mean, you're not missing any gas stations.
No, that's for sure.
If there's a gas station, you know where it is. You'll want to know where it is.
Now what's interesting about this one is that these SRTs, there's always that desire. Everyone likes the big horsepower.
Demand.
Obviously, Dodge Chrysler FCA now. Mm. They've done an incredible job at the big horsepower.
It's actually PSA too.
PSA now.
They're now Peugeot. They've all merged.
Well, no, they've even changed their name from then as well. It's hard to keep up these days.
Yeah, well, there's a lot of mergers, yeah.
But what's interesting is that cars like this, especially being early 2000s, or should I say late 2010s, which is starting to be that weird, like,
Who would think anything, not much would be collectible, especially an SUV.
Yes.
But there are other SUVs that have value.
Yeah, so they've dropped in value, but now they're coming back up. So if you bought one when it was cheaper because it was a good buy, because you wanted cheap horsepower. Who doesn't want cheap horsepower?
Yeah, well, there's always deals when it comes to FCA, unless it's the super collectibles.
Right, so now the price is coming back up. It's not quite to where it was new at just shy of $40,000, but it's getting there. So it might be a good buy for you to get into something like this now.
You know, it says it's up 8.3%. Haggerty likes this vehicle. vehicle. They think it's a future collectible. I don't know. Do SUVs hold value down the road? I mean,
I guess it really depends.
There's a few exceptions, like the Alfa Romeo Stelvio N-Ring. Maybe. It's a cool car.
I seriously believe that's going to be worth a lot of money somewhere in the future just because it's a special edition. Not today.
But if you can find one used in a lot that is low mileage or the dealer got stuck with it. Yeah. Now you're talking about
it. Or give it 20 years.
Yeah, but that's a long time to own an SUV.
I wouldn't.
You know.
And by the way, on the note of SUVs, this up here is my current vehicle.
There's a demand for that one because I have Cayenne a newer diesel. Vehicle. Yeah, Cayenne diesels. I've had more people offer to buy my vehicle.
Yep.
Not for sale.
Neither is mine.
Yeah. The reason is 700 miles on a tank and 30 miles to the gallon all day long. And
32 on a good day.
Yeah, 32 on a good day. Well, it depends how you drive. If you drive like me, it's... maybe 30.
I'm not any better.
So the thing is, if you can find those, they're in high demand because of the long warranty.
Right.
10-year, 100,000-mile warranty that's been extended. So there's a lot, like I said, that doesn't make it a collectible. It just makes it a car that people desire.
Right.
There's a difference.
It just goes to show that there are some exceptions to the rule that, you know, it has to be a sports car or it has to be a convertible or it has to have a lot of horsepower. Sometimes it just has to be something unique or something that has a story like Dieselgate, which has completely changed the story on diesels.
For collectors. Because the average person, you stop anyone on the street and go, hey, what do you know about diesel and Volkswagen? They go, I don't know. What? They sell them, don't they? I mean, there's no clue. It's like asking them about ignition switches in GM. They're like,
wait, that happened how long ago?
They don't even know.
Yeah.
It cost Volkswagen billions of dollars for their little screw-up.
Was it almost 7 years ago now?
Yeah, it's amazing. But it worked out good for me because I got money from Volkswagen. Yeah. You know, it's funny. One of the things you're talking about sports cars.
Yes.
I always say, are all Ferraris red? Or is it a pigment of your imagination? My father had a yellow Ferrari, believe it or not. So,
no, it was red. What are you talking about?
He had a yellow one, too. All right. It was a pigment of my imagination. One of the cars on the list is a 1984 to 1991 Ferrari Testarossa. I had an opportunity to drive one at Watkins Glen. I was teaching. I've been an instructor for racing since the 80s, and I got a chance. Guy says, hey, you want to drive my Testarossa on Watkins Glen? I said yes before he could finish his sentence. And I was actually disappointed in how it handled on the track, having driven other Ferraris.
Well, it's an 80s Ferrari. None of them were very impressive, unfortunately.
But suddenly they've popped in value.
Right. And if you look at the list from last year, I think the 355 or the 550, one of the other 80s Ferraris was on that list.
308s have gone up even.
Just for some reason, these 80s Ferraris are starting to become
more
popular.
Those are not fun to work on either.
No, and they're just not, they don't have the je ne sais quoi that the Ferraris have.
A little French.
Ouais, juste un petit. No, but they don't drive like Ferraris because of there was the gas crisis and they were trying to re-engineer and kind of get around.
And the prices were high, and that Testarossa was about $165,000.
Which at the time was, you know, equivalent value was way higher than that. It's just...
Right. But look what they're worth today.
Right. And honestly, at this
95 to 110, somewhere in that range. We're talking about number two quality cars. That's like, there's, you know, they're not perfect, pristine, wrapped in plastic. Yeah. These are like nicely maintained cars.
I think that's fair to say for every vehicle on this list, when we give you values of what it currently goes for on the market, it'd be like cars that maybe were daily driven a little bit and have some miles on them. They're not show condition cars, because show condition cars, the values can go anywhere. They can go up into the stratosphere. It could have been the first car.
There's a lot of cars, and there's a couple on this list that if they've got no miles on them, they just jack
rocket
up
ship.
Oh,
yeah, absolutely.
But so I think the thing that's impressive about it, the high speeds at the time in the 80s, that was a pretty fast car. That was a pretty unique looking car with the side, you know, the lines on the side. Yep. But if you drive the thing today, it is dated. I had a 1986 Pantera GT5, very limited production, not the 5S. And it had that same type of like, it was okay. It was cool looking.
Yep.
It was okay. I mean, you're talking about performance cars and things that handle in contact with the ground.
Well, you're talking about a 4.9 liter flat 12.
Right.
That only put out less than 400 horsepower.
No, isn't that crazy?
Which is just sad.
But it weighed 3,800 pounds. I mean, that was a, you know.
Well, technology.
Horsepower to weight ratio wasn't
great. Well, you have to keep in mind that the emissions actually really kept it down. And obviously maintenance costs are factored into that when you have one of these vehicles. But this brings up a really interesting point. These are the affordable Ferrari. Do you want an exotic car? Would you like it in Ferrari red? Well, you can get a cheap Ferrari. That's okay. That looks okay. But it's a Ferrari, and you have a Ferrari.
That's what 308s were.
Yeah.
You know, it's funny because my father always bought the cars wrong. As a matter of fact, today's his birthday when we're recording this.
Yes.
He would always buy high and though sell it low. And I'm like, I think you got that backwards.
Right.
He bought a fiberglass 308. And I'm like, well, why would you buy that? Well, it was great. And of course, he bought it symbolic, which is like the most expensive Ferrari place on the planet. Yep. For those of you who aren't into the Ferrari world. And then he tried to sell it and he got killed. And I said, you got this backwards. So the key is, this is what we keep telling you. It's about doing the research, about buying it at the right time and really getting involved in the forums and knowing the people, joining the clubs so that you buy the right thing and ask people, because the deeper you're into it, like if you want to talk about Shelby's, you call me and I'll tell you, I'll tell you what years to buy and what not to buy.
Yep.
You know what I mean? And he's really into different German cars. So, and this is kind of stuff that we research every single day.
Yep.
And although we do talk about everyday drivers, sometimes we talk about cars that we really like.
Well,
this
is all we talk about at the kitchen table.
Jeez. Right. Well, he doesn't live with me, but you know what I mean? When he comes over for dinner. So a friend of ours just sold one of these. This is the next one on the list is a 2005 to 27 Aston Martin V8 Vantage.
Oh, yes.
Please. It looks good. But boy, after talking to a friend of ours who had it,
yeah,
he was really disappointed. He's an exotics car guy. Mm-hmm. 4.3 liter V8, 380 horsepower, 302 pound-feet of torque, weighs about 3,600 pounds.
As long as you can deal with English engineering and the
electronics and the lovely
department.
Transmission.
And the transmission.
Well, they don't have Lucas Electrical. So anyone who knows about old British cars, the Lucas Electrical is the prince of darkness. the British drink warm beer because they have Lucas refrigerators, for all my friends who know about what I'm talking about. There was a wiring company called Lucas, and they always had issues. And they were in every single British car. And there's a reason the British don't build cars like they used to.
Well, I don't think the British build any cars anymore. Maybe the
Well,
Mini.
They do, but they don't own it. They just don't own it anymore. Yeah. Well, they still build Rolls and whatever.
Oh, sure.
So, but as far as price, these cars ran around $110,000. Of course, you could load them up with more.
Right.
But today, you can pick one up for $45,000 to $52,000.
Now, that is a nice, affordable, entry-level super. As long as you can...
It looks good. You can drive that, well, not every day in the winter, but you could probably drive that, you know, every day.
I wouldn't drive it in the winter, but... I mean, it still has the looks because I think a lot of
James
people...
James Bond.
Yes, it's James Bond. And
it's Bond, James Bond.
Yes, shaking that stirred.
Right.
So, I mean, this up to 2017 is what they say for this V8 Vantage, Haggerty says. And honestly...
You got to do your homework on what year is right.
Oh, yeah. I think...
Because they had a couple of transmission problems early on. I would say the later years would be better. And if you're really unsure...
You're going to get in the weeds here.
Yeah,
really deep
without
in
getting in the weeds, I would say go to a place like Haggerty, go to the Aston Martin websites, talk to people that have the car, and they'll guide you. But the later ones have less issues than the earlier ones. And that's probably much true with anything in these ranges.
Right, and honestly, I think I'd go as far as to say that if you are looking in the market for like a $90,000 supercar, and you want to buy something like this that's like less than $50,000 and just keep the extra money for repairs, I think...
You're going to need it.
Well, I mean, yeah.
You better know how to work with the tools.
But that's fair for any 2000 supercar is that while they're really affordable now, you're starting to get into unforeseen circumstances with repair bills. I mean,
right. And you got to find someone that knows what they're talking about.
Yes. Well, I mean, for
example, there's always somebody in every town. You just got to find them. Got to ask around.
I would say, for example, you go in and you want to buy an R8. You can get one for about $60,000 to $70,000.
They're still cool.
The second you buy one, you're immediately going to have to switch
transaxles.
The transaxle, the suspension, and you're probably going to need to clean the carbon deposits out of the engine. And I think things like that are standard.
And you got to watch the thing with the transaxle. Everybody that had them originally launched them.
That's
I had a V10. It was an awesome car, and I had to get rid of it because someone just beat the snot out of it. And it was a media car. Yeah. And
we think we know who did it, our friends
I know,
out there.
It was Paul Tracy is one of them. So I go looking it up on YouTube. I'm like, oh, I wonder what this car is, because I got a good deal on the car. And I'm like, oh, and I'm watching him launch a mid-engine sports car and doing burnouts with it. I'm like, okay, now I know why the car runs like crap. So I had to get rid of it quickly. Thank God I broke even on it. Let's move on to the next vehicle. Yeah, well, he's tough on vehicles in general. I know he's running an SVRA and Trans Am right now. So 1964 to 1970 Honda S600 and S800. Now, if you don't know what that is, I think it's kind of ugly.
Really? I thought it was good looking.
I don't like them. I don't know. They look British to me.
Well, yeah, because they kind of went up against like the Spitfire and the MGs and the Triumphs. And honestly,
different cars, though. It's a Japanese car.
To me,
they
look like a miniature like fair lady. I think they're really cool looking.
I would never own one. If I had a collection, you had unlimited cash, would you buy this car? No.
No, it's got 57 horsepower. I want to drive it.
It's so funny. It's like buying a little Fiat Jolly, you know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
Those are up in value. But that's all deeper into the weeds.
But this is within the first 10 years of Honda coming to the automotive market.
Right.
So it's one of their super early
cars. I buy a
Civic.
I buy a teeny little Civic first.
And honestly, if you look at the car, it looks a lot like a Civic.
Or even a CRV. Not a CRV, the CRX. That was great. We autocrossed those cars.
Well, yeah, sure. But I don't think they're going to be a collector car. Not like this. As I mean, this never came to the U.S.
Right. And that's part of the problem. You can't get them so easily. But cars do I mean, we've sold cars overseas. Right? 25-year-old rule. Used to be you could bring one car over a lifetime. I have a friend who did it with a Ferrari. Mm-hmm. The one Ferrari, you wouldn't want to own a 365. But
no, thank you.
Yeah, yeah. It's one of the hardest ones. You restore it, put more money into it than you ever get out of it.
There's a lot of those.
There's a lot of cars that... But you can bring a car over now that's 25 years old, and this is one of those. And I think one of the things, the value's up 17, almost 18%.
Yeah.
And you can pick one up between 30 and 40,000. Of course, you know, what do you want? What year? What
Especially
condition?
When you're originally buying it for $1,600.
Right.
But if you're going to buy one of these, it's going to be a long-term hold.
Yes.
Because you never know what's going to happen in the market. It's going to be like a long-term stock.
And you're not going to sell it.
No, and you're going to keep it in good condition.
But selling it and finding a buyer is always a challenge.
That's going to be hard. Because this is a weird one. And there's not. Yeah. I got to imagine that there's not a lot of them. I don't think we have numbers on that. And
no, the production is super low. But, you think
but it's going to be rare in the U.S. And that's going to be huge. But you do have to worry about importation and all the
because they may,
BS that
they
comes along with that.
Make you change over the speedometer and everything. But if they do, like my buddy did with his Ferrari,
I don't think they would because it's technically classified as a classic car.
Right.
But then again, you can only import classic cars because of the 25-year rule. So any car that's 25 years old is immediately classified as a classic.
Well, that brings me to
does not follow current motoring laws.
Well, as far as safety features, but
that's the way that you get around it.
But
right?
We should put a little plug in because this list comes from Hagerty.com, and I get my insurance for my collectible cars from them. So they are good companies. So if you're thinking about insuring a collectible, we're not getting paid for this. Hagerty.com, check it out. They're kind of fun site.
They're also a wonderful resource for doing all kinds of research like this, and you can really dig into it. They do a lot of fun articles and reviews and things like that. So if you are interested in learning more, definitely a good resource to check out as well.
Right. The next car on the list is a 1980 to 1991 Volkswagen Vanagon Westfalia. Honestly, I think it's ugly. But you know what? People collect 21 window buses, and they're super popular. There's a comedian that collects them as well. He's been on Jay Leno.
Gabriel Iglesias.
Yes, they call him Fluffy.
Fluffy!
Yes. Very funny guy, but loves them. I mean,
yeah.
It's sort of like a Pontiac Aztec. There are people... Ugly car. Horrid car.
Well, I think
but
the difference...
there are certain unique vehicles that people just have a huge following for, and I think this is one of them.
Yeah, and there's also a huge VW van lifestyle that's getting... You know, I want to say
a California thing. Sorry if you're from California.
Well, it's a California thing. It's a road tripping thing. I mean, it's getting bigger and bigger. It's definitely bigger on the West Coast than it is on the East Coast. But
soon you won't be able to drive it in California. Sorry.
Well, yeah. I mean, take a trip out to one of those big concerts out there. You know,
right.
You're gonna see 100 of these things riding around because they're cheap and they're fun. But now, as more people buy them, I think that they're starting to become collectibles simply because of the popularity of people wanting to have them. I don't think it's a collectible in the sense that...
Depends what year you were
born. Like the Aston Martin is a collectible.
Right. I think it's the year you were born. What's the car you remember? Were your parents part of it? You know, peace, love, rock and roll, sun and moons. If that was the case, you were a child of the 70s, which I think I kind of just beyond that. That's the car that your parents may have had in the driveway. And so I think that's sort of become that... I remember those days when we would jump in the van and
More simply, it's just a car that's becoming more popular and could be a good buy so you can ride the wave of the market going up.
And watch it. You got to watch a market like this.
And they're fairly affordable too.
They came in at $9,500 originally. They just got a little 2-liter engine. I think every manufacturer makes a 2-liter engine. They're saying values at $27,000 to $36,000. That's up about 3%.
And I would say actually finding a number two, like how we discuss it's kind of a daily driver
challenge.
That could be a challenge. These are going to be like,
They're
going to be like number three, number four vehicles. They're going to need work. But if you just want to buy one to drive it, you're fine. If you want to buy one to sell it, you'll probably be fine.
Right.
But if you want to buy one to like live the lifestyle, you're going to have to put money into it.
Right. I don't think there's a choice. And that's when people start upgrading and that's what the aftermarket's for.
And I think that's where the Vanagon Westfalia kind of, specifically the Vanagon Westfalia, but really the Vanagon is kind of the odd one out on this list, I would say.
Now the next one we've had two of. It's a 05-06 Ford GT.
Oh, I love it.
You love it. I want to give you one thing. If you ever buy an 05-06 GT or ride in someone's car, watch your head.
Yes.
I cracked my head so bad because the door, the wings on the door, they take a ton of space in your garage. Mm-hmm. So as the door would open, you think you cleared it and you'd like move your head. I cracked my head. I sat on the floor in the garage going, oh my God, am I going to pass out? So, you know, be careful on those type of doors of any vehicle.
Well, you know why that's there. I know you know why.
Go ahead, you
but
tell them.
For the original GT40, they were 40 inches tall. And right. So they had to be really tight. So in order for the driver to get in and out, they had to cut open a hole that the driver would plop into, and then they had a little bump
over. Well, it was for racing. The bump was for Gurney, for Dan Gurney. For, yeah. They called it a Gurney bump. But they didn't have those in these cars, unfortunately. Right. And not everybody could fit into them. However.
But they needed that extra space to get in, and now they kept it for style, and it's really cool, but you can crack your head so easily.
Well, that's when the door swings out.
Yeah, don't park close to anything.
Right. So they're all powered the same 5.4 liter V8 supercharged 6-speed real manual transmission, 550 horsepower, 500 pound feet of torque, 3,500 pounds. And they came in when they came out at like $150,000. And what's interesting about these cars is when they came out on the marketplace, the popular colors like red and blue and black and the yellow cars, you could not sell those to save your life. And then when they came out with the Heritage, team colors, which I like and are now worth the most value, nobody wanted them. I remember telling my husband, I said, hey, we should get one of those blue and orange ones. He goes, oh, it's so ugly. And I said, I don't know. I got this gut feeling. And I was right. They're going to go up in value. Now, if you've got a Heritage car in Golf Team colors, as in Golf Oil, and it's low mileage, and the plastic's still on it. You know, it's still on what they call the MSO. It means never titled. Those are the cars they're taking that are getting the most money. Isn't that interesting?
Yeah. And honestly, these things look incredible.
They do. And they're still cool cars.
They drive great. They got a lot of horsepower.
Right. But there's a lot of them that got wrecked.
That's true as well. And I don't think that they're going to need a lot of maintenance either. They're pretty solid cars as far as what
Ford.
I'm hearing.
They're Ford built. And I think the difference between this car and the new car is this was a Ford built product. In a Ford plant. And they wanted to go racing and they did it. And I've talked to the designers. I know all the people on the team and so forth. And these cars were great. When you look at a new GT, different story. Built by Multimatic. And you can check out up here. We did a full factory review. I thought that the new GT was totally different. It was built for racing and then sort of brought down for the street. But it is a supercar. I love ours, and I'm constantly talking about it because I think that was the best car Ford built. But they didn't really build it. Multimatic built it. So the thing about the 0506 GT is if you can find one that hasn't been damaged, and believe me, there's a full list. There is a GT forum. There's a list of everything. There's a full documentation on every car. So cars that have provenance, which is, does it has history, it has a full heritage behind it. It is limited production. It had high demand. Those are the cars that are collectible. So make sure that if you're seriously going to invest in one, I actually just saw one the other day for about $298,000. So it had some miles on it.
Okay.
I know that like Doug DeMuro has one. Carl Brower has a new one like I do. Mm-hmm. And so when you look at that, you're now talking about $300,000 to $395,000. That's down about 2%. And you think,
it's still really solid.
It's still very solid. And you'll see them go at auctions. But I would say if you're going to buy one, don't buy it at the auction.
No.
You want to buy it from someone on one of the forums because they're going to know a full history and everything is documented, just like it is on a 65 Shelby, like it is on the older Camaros, like it is on certain Corvettes. So make sure you get documentation when you're going to spend this kind of cash.
Yeah. Yeah. And even as the market's gone down, it's still a very strong buy and you could buy it and
you won't get hurt.
You won't get hurt.
And if you can find a new one, especially if the guy's got a divorce or a woman has a divorce,
it's a great long
fire sales. We like those. That's the best time to buy a car.
I think it's only going to go up as the years go on. I think this year just down a tick, but it's going to be a good buy. Now moving on to something that I think you and I both vehemently disagree on.
Yes. And I've had I had an 09 of this version, which I love.
This is the 2000 to 2006 Audi TT Quattro, the original Audi TT, named after the Isle of Man touring competition, which is used to be a very, very famous rally for motorcycles.
Right.
But anyway, so this car came out and it kind of shook up the market a little bit. It was this cool little coupe.
Right.
It had all-wheel drive, which is very, very unusual.
But Quattro is all-wheel drive. That's Audi's like big thing.
Well, this isn't real Quattro, but that's another conversation for another time. They used
a
different system.
That's for deeper in the weeds.
Yeah. But it came with a manual, had about 180 horsepower, and sold for about $30,000.
They had some interesting options. Like you could do the baseball stitching on the seats.
Actually, That is the most valuable version of the car.
And it's ugly.
Personally, yes, it's ugly. But I think
it looks like a baseball mitt. It's like that weird brown.
Yes.
Like that medium brown.
And it has the baseball stitching.
And it has the baseball stitching.
But I think if you're going to buy one of these as a collector, that's the only one to buy.
Well,
personally, I don't agree with Haggerty here.
Right, I don't agree with Haggerty here either. They're saying it's actually gone down in value. They were $30,000 cars. Those early Audis, the first gen, which this is,
yep,
had a very specific look to them. And if they weren't maintained, they're expensive to maintain. But the other part of it is, I think when you're looking at these type of Audis, you need to know that when you're buying one, you're buying it from someone who really doesn't want to sell it. They're very passionate. There's even one that's down the street from us. It sits outside.
Yep.
They beat the heck out of it.
Yep.
The kids drive it.
Because you can drive them year round.
Right. You can. But I think the thing is,
I would.
Those who buy them, it's very niche. So yeah. I had an 09 TTS, mm-hmm, and it was solar orange with an orange and black interior. It was a media car. It was on the cover of Car and Driver and a bunch of other cars, magazines, and I loved it. And I drove it until I decided to move on to an RS5, yep, which I'm glad I did, actually. Last of the V8s.
Right, but this one's actually really affordable right now. It's super. It's about $10,000 to about $16,000.
But find one that's not rotted, that hasn't done high mileage. Mm. Find one that hasn't been abused. The maintenance is key on these vehicles. And so this is where I don't agree with them is the value. I would think the next gen would be the TTS, the TTRS with a manual.
Those actually,
I've been monitoring
those. Hold their value fairly well. There's not a lot of fluctuation
there.
Try to
find a TTRS manual that hasn't been abused or modified.
They only
is a
came
challenge.
In manual. That's the good news. Yeah. But if you're going to buy one of those, you hold on to it. You take really good care of it. You sell it and you get your money back.
True.
And that's about the most
pricey.
You're going to. Yes.
So we looked at a new
TT. About 40-ish, I want to say.
Yeah, but looking at a new TTRS, that's a used.
Yeah.
They only come in Tiptronic. They only come in automatic,
the
essentially.
Brand new ones, yeah.
And you're looking at a car. As a matter of fact, my daughter looking at one. It was like $78,000. I go, that's a lot of money.
Yeah.
And obviously she didn't buy it, but you think, I got 78 grand sitting here. There's a lot of choices. And I don't know. I mean, I'd be looking at like, I don't know, a lot of cars.
There's a lot of other cars.
I don't want to go down the list because my brain just runs of 1,000 different cars that you could potentially own.
No, I don't think
I think this is not a collectible. No, I would not recommend this.
I think maybe at some point it's going to be one of those niche cars, like how the 350Z became popular.
Right. I had a 280ZX. Mm. Of course, it rotted and frame broke in half. Yeah, but that's another story for another time.
And
too.
Anyway, so we're going to move on to an interesting one here.
This is a very unusual
and it's
vehicle.
A real classic.
Yes.
This is a 1948 to 54 Jaguar XK120, which I think is the most valuable of the classic XKs. I think it's one of the most.
Well, not going D-type and stuff like that.
Right,
some of the Jags you can get. We have a friend who's the number one Jaguar expert in the world. And I mean, if you're looking at D-types, race cars, Jaguar is the way to go. But this is a really.
It's a passenger car.
Right. When you're thinking about Jaguar and your head goes right to those, not the new cars, goes to the old cars. It goes to the cars of the 40s and 50s that made
them. This is the one that's in your head.
Right. And the value's gone down, unfortunately. So it's a good time to buy. But before you buy anything like this, again, we were talking about Lucas Electrical.
Yep.
We're talking about collectible cars. Mm-hmm. You really have to keep that in mind. It doesn't have a lot of horsepower. 180 horsepower, 203 pound-feet of torque. So more torque than horsepower means it's got a little bit of get up and go. Mm-hmm. It weighs about 2,900 pounds. So the horsepower to weight ratio is pretty good. And it came originally, it was only $3,900. Mm-hmm. But remember, in 1948, $3,900 is like saying $300,000 today. Mm-hmm. I mean, neither of us were alive. So.
No,
but
I'd say if you're going to buy one of these, this is one of those short or long term investments. I think this is just a good investment.
It's a lovely
in general.
Car.
It is, but it's not a driver car.
It might be the one
that you drive to the local shows. Mm. You know, maybe you show it off.
Yeah,
you know.
Or Jaguar Club for sure. There's a huge Jaguar Club.
You get together with your buds and you show off the car. But
if you dream about this car, you won't get hurt. You know, the value's down right now, but that doesn't mean much.
But especially with the age, unless you're doing a full restoration, in which case, obviously, the value would be way lower than what's showing here. It'd be, you know.
So
far
you know
more
what?
Affordable. And it's a different kind of market there.
Yeah.
If you're going to buy a number two car, you're going to own it for a little bit. You're going to sell it and you're going to make a little bit of money. And
you hope. If you sell it right. You got to watch the timing on things.
Right. But with these classic cars, they just seem to, as the years go on, go up in value as long as they're in good condition, because it becomes harder and harder to find vehicles that are in good condition.
Right. I think the thing is, here we are in 2020 looking at cars that are well over 50 years old.
Yeah.
Now, what are the collectible cars today? If you said all right, you can buy a couple cars that are collectible. I'm going to buy it off the lot from the dealer and hope not to pay over sticker. And there's a lot of cars, like if you looked at Toyota, the Venza, or, you know, a hybrid or a plug-in, people think they're worth something. There's a demand for it, but it's a short-term demand. Mm. What's going to hold its value that I'm going to buy today or in the last few years that I know I won't get hurt?
Sure. And not only not get hurt, but, you know, like a Wrangler is going to hold its value. It's always going to hold its value.
Or
every Wrangler
or
has.
Toyota, you know, a Toyota Tacoma.
Sure. Those are going to hold their value.
Always, always sell. You will not get
but
hurt.
But we're going to talk about making money on your car.
Well, then first car comes to mind to me is Ford announcing they're no longer making the GT350 or 350R.
Which is pretty much an immediate red flag to everybody that owns one or wants to buy one to keep it
or
buy one right now.
Or sell it immediately on eBay.
Or sell it immediately.
Or bring a trailer. Yeah,
the market's going to go crazy.
But
and
there's
not only
one,
that,
there's one that you really
it makes
want.
It exclusive.
Right, but there's one that's more exclusive than the others. Sure, you can buy a 350 or a 350R. You can make it any way you want. You want the Heritage Edition. That's Wimbledon White and Guardsman Blue.
Yep.
That is the one to have. And it happened to be that we bought one and I had ordered it and it took forever to get here. And it shows up, of course, in 2020 because I had ordered it in 2019. No one knew it was going to happen. And, you know, I was shocked that it was going up. They stopped that. So I said, oh, well, I guess I'm keeping this car. Mm-hmm. But I'd also say the 2020 Shelby GT500, if it's what they call a golden ticket car.
Mm-hmm.
That's another collectible. That means it's got the carbon pack. And we reviewed that too. You can check that out up here.
The performance pack, the carbon pack, and I think the nav?
The tech pack.
The tech
pack. You want, if it's not fully loaded, doesn't have every single thing that's with painted stripes, not the vinyl stripes,
mm-hmm.
those are the ones that are going to hold their value. The earlier the number. The reason you want the early number is a lot of people don't know this, but the first 30 cars or 39 cars have matching numbers.
To the VINs. Like
to the VIN. Your vehicle identification number matches the Shelby number. After that, they're just randoms.
And that's the same thing goes for the GT350s, the GT350Rs, and I believe the Heritages as well.
The Heritage is a random number, unfortunately.
Oh, it is? Okay.
Yeah. We collect certain cars, certain numbers.
That's something that we care a lot about because we really love classic 60s Mustangs, but I don't know if that's going to be important at all going into the future. Maybe like 30, 40 years, 60 years into the future.
Well, I'm not keeping those cars this long.
No, but I think that at some point in the future, someone might be, well, my car is numbers matching.
Well, that is important. If you look at Corvettes, NCRS, the National Corvette Restorers Association, if your numbers aren't matching, you'll never win.
Yeah, that's fair.
And that's true with Camaros as well. So there's a lot of cars that's really important to have original engines and original vehicle identification numbers, especially if a car's been in an accident. So other cars, everyone knows I love Fords, but there's other cars out there.
Mm.
I think the new Corvette, if you buy one today and you sell it within 6 months to a year, you'll be okay. But once they start coming out with the ZR1 and the Z06 and all these other cool, we're hearing there's going to be a Zora, like Zora Arkastantov, the father of the Corvette. Mm-hmm. That'll be next year. You want to watch for that because that could be a potential collectible.
I actually disagree with you there.
Really?
I don't think that the standard Corvette's going to be worth anything special.
If you can't get one. It's got to be a Z51.
Fair.
It's got to be
but
something
I think they're
special.
Making too many. I think they're making way too many.
Not this year.
If they do that limited edition like you're saying, and they actually keep it limited like they're saying, then it's going to be worth something
right.
in about 5 years
well,
or so.
Well, I wouldn't wait 5 years. If you bought a new Corvette, get rid of it quickly.
Well, if you bought it and you sell it immediately because they're so hard to get a hold of, then yeah, of course you're going to
get because
the
production
money.
Stopped. They're short parts.
Right. It's almost impossible. The supply is so minimal.
Right. Now, here's another car. We just reviewed this with another member of our team, Chris Saley. You can check that out up here. That is the 2021 Ram TRX.
The T-Rex.
The T-Rex, yes. Going after the Raptor, which is also a collector. You buy a Raptor, you will not get hurt. That's the Ford version of it, but the Raptor kicks its butt, so I'm waiting. For Ford.
The TRX kicks its butt.
Yeah, the TRX, well, like, and not in the dinosaurs. That must be something that somebody...
I'm pretty sure they did that intentionally.
Yeah.
And let's be honest, the Ram truck for this generation is really, really good.
Yeah.
And putting that much horsepower in it has pretty much solidified it as the truck to have.
That's true. I think so. And then, now Ford's are coming out, what we hear, the rumor mill, was probably pretty true, that there's going to be a bigger engine coming out. That's going to be the Shelby GT500 motor, did I hear? In an F-150? Oh, I have to have one of those.
Rumors right now, but we'll see. I mean, they did come out with the Tremor.
It's a hypothetical, as
and the,
they say.
And the Tremor's really cool.
It's not enough yet.
Yeah, you can go look that up. It's interesting. It's on its way, but it's not quite there.
Not quite there.
And I think they definitely need to get up into that 700 horsepower range.
They have to. If you can't compete,
Or at least Ram close. Wins. And it can have less horsepower, but be better performing.
Right.
And that'll do it for the Ford guys, honestly. Right.
So that's trucks. What about other cars? What other cars are being produced today where you say, oh, that is going to have some value?
I think the number of vehicles on the market that are going to be collectibles is
minimal.
It's shrinking.
Well, obviously the Ferraris. The Demon, and the Hellcat without question. Because they're something that people love. And
but
it's
a lot of
cheap
the sporty little daily drivers, they're not going to be valuable. Not like how, the Honda S2000 or
well, the Miata's always fun, but I don't think you're going to make money on it.
Civic Type R or something. You know, the
Civic Type R does pretty good, though.
Right.
But you are going to take a hit initially.
That era's kind of gone, unfortunately. I don't think that's going to pop up like that for a while longer.
Certain German
people look
cars.
Back at current cars.
We'll be having a review coming up of the new 2021 BMW M2CS. Very short production run. Every single one was pre-sold.
Yep. That's
before
gonna
they
be,
even saw the car.
That's going to be a great car.
I got
be a
to
good
drive it on
well.
The track. And we'll have a review coming up on that very soon. Mm-hmm. So don't forget to subscribe.
So last thing to throw on there, the Camaro ZL1.
Oh, yeah. You know, a friend of mine has one. Mm-hmm. And he said to me, I went to his house. He goes, tosses me the keys. He goes, take it for a spin. I'm like, really?
You don't have to ask me twice.
No. Yeah. I didn't have to finish a sentence. So, of course, I took off in it and left rubber out of his driveway. Awesome, powerful vehicle. Really, really cool. So, I mean, when you're looking at vehicles, does it have to be performance? No, it doesn't. It has to have a demand.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, every daily driver out there, yeah, you'll get your resale out of it. There's a lot of good vehicles out there on the market.
It has to have some history.
It has
definitely.
To have significant
it's gotta have
provenance.
A story behind it.
Right. And that's the bottom line, as we keep saying. The bottom line is three things if you're going to buy a car. It's got to have history, significant, called provenance.
Mm-hmm.
But it also has to have limited production. And I think that's important because I think people forget that. So,
yep.
And there has to be a demand because if there's no demand, then they're not going to make it anymore. And yep. So that's kind of what happens in many cases.
Right. And that's why, the C8 may be mm-hmm. one of those cars in the future. I mean, it's the first mid-engine Corvette. It's
right.
It's what the Corvette was originally meant to be. Now, if they put a rotary mid-engine in it, then that's going to be... That was the original design of the
Corvette.
It's
not going to be rotary. The only one that ever did rotary was Wankel engines that were in the Mazdas. And they're supposedly going to start doing this.
They've been threatening to bring back rotaries for a while. And if
cool.
they do, keep an eye out because that car will
ago.
Be valuable.
Yeah, like an RX-7 with twin turbos. That's the kind of thing that has value. I mean, they're really like you get deep into the weeds. If you're thinking about collectibles, what I'd like you to do is write your favorite collectible down in the comments down below. Mm-hmm. And if we get any questions about cars, what do you think? We'll also comment. Paul and I will both be commenting.
Yep.
And check out our website. We expanded our website. It's in English and Spanish. We have a lot of new contributors because we want to give you as much information, not just about cars and first looks, but about creating car smarts. And also, I do a podcast called Total Car Score with Javier Mota and Carl Brower. And as we grow, we want you to grow with us. We want you to continue to communicate and follow me on all forms of social media at Lauren Fix. How do they find you?
You can find me at all forms of social media at PaulFix3. Nice and easy.
And really easy. And of course, we appreciate you supporting us and we will look forward to seeing you next time. Don't forget those comments because we will answer.
Yep. See ya.
Take care.